In Jesus' name, welcome to Trinity Lutheran Church, because today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
And it is a beautiful day to come together on this first Sunday of Advent, as we are so quickly moving into this holiday season of Advent and Christmas.
That's right. And as we prepare for the arrival of Jesus' birth and that Christmas celebration, we have some opportunities for caroling. Our first Wednesday event this month that will take place on December 6th, this Wednesday at 6:30, we will meet together at the church, get on a bus, and go out to local homes throughout our community to spread the good news of Jesus' birth and the celebration of Christmas through song. And that's our first option to go caroling, is to be a part of that evening, and which will conclude with hot chocolate and cookies.
That is correct.
And then the second opportunity for caroling will fall on December 10th. After worship, we'll gather in the foyer of the gathering space at 11, and then we'll walk or drive to the memory care, assisted living, and the nursing homes so that we can continue to spread that good news of Jesus' birth connected to the Christmas season with everyone there as well.
Exactly. It's a beautiful time, and it's a fun to kind of prepare, like you said, in this Advent season. But with that being said, also on the 17th of December is our Christmas program that our young people have been working very hard on preparing for that and that celebration. So we invite you to be a part of that on the 17th of December as well.
And if you've got a grandchild or niece or nephew or even a sibling or someone that you know that would like to be a part of that Christmas pageant, really the ages from 3 all the way up through 8th grade at this point is inclusive of the parts included in that pageant. Let us know, because we're reaching out to families. We want as many people to be a part of telling that Christmas story in such a special way from our young people.
Exactly. So my friends, as we start this preparation, as we move through Advent, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Hark the glad sound, the Savior comes, the Savior comes. Satan's bondage hell, the gates of brass before him burst, the blessed fetters yield. He comes the broken heart to bind, the bleeding souls to cure, and with the treasures His grace to bless the humble poor. Our glad Hosanna, Prince of Peace, thy welcome shall proclaim, and heaven's eternal arches ring with our beloved name.
I invite you now into our time of confession and forgiveness. God, we hear your invitation to us.
Come to me, you who are weary and heavy burdened, I will give you rest.
We acknowledge our soul's need for rest and quiet nourishment.
We lay down our burdens.
We acknowledge our soul's need of connection with you.
We confess our tendency to overlook rest as a necessary part of soul and self-care. We confess our pride in thinking that our work is so important that we may not set it down. We confess our readiness to believe that what we do determines our worth. We confess our obsession with productivity, results, measurable progress. We confess our tendency to forget that it is in you that we live and move and have our being, and that your love is better than life.
We ask now for body, mind, spirit, whole person nourishment,
for rest and resurrection, for new life, for healing and consolation of our souls.
We ask for help in managing our time and our activities so that our
infillings keep up with our outpourings.
Where we have overspent ourselves,
refresh us.
Where we have misplaced our priorities,
rearrange us.
Where we have said yes when we should have said no,
remind us.
We thank you for meaningful work, for blessings and burdens.
We thank you for rest. May we become present to our great need for daily bread, the presence of Christ in our lives.
Amen. Hear the good news. The good news of peace and salvation. God forgives us all our sins, not through our own works, but through Jesus Christ, risen from the dead. Rejoice in this amazing gift of grace.
Amen. Alleluia. Well, good morning and welcome to our children's message. And you may be wondering, what are we standing next to? And this is an Advent wreath where we light one candle each Sunday leading up to Christmas in anticipation of the arrival of Jesus and his birth on Christmas. Now, the first candle, which is right next to Alan, we acknowledge as hope. And I want to share with you what that means before we light any candles so that we can have a discussion together. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of hope. Our hope is in God and his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the one appointed by God to be the judge of all things. He is the one through whom God has promised to save and redeem his people. We light this candle today to remind us that he is our hope and the hope of the world. We thank God for the promises he has made to us and for the light he has brought into the world. But I invite us to have a discussion, Alan, of the importance of hope and how Jesus provides that to you, to me, and to people of all ages.
Exactly, Pastor Eric. You know, if we had no hope, if we had no hope, we would be lost and in despair. Have you ever found yourself sometimes, kids, where there wasn't any hope? Or you are hoping for something to happen. You're hoping for Christmas to come. I'm hoping for a gift under the Christmas tree, maybe. Hope helps us to be excited and ready and wanting to move forward. And that's the hope that we're talking about here this Christmas, this Advent candle, is this hope and this anticipation of a baby being born to us.
And the core of that hope is how Jesus fulfills a promise through Scripture for all of us, that Jesus came to be born into this world knowing that he would then journey on through a life of ministry, have his death on the cross, but we're able to have hope in Jesus, hope in his death, and hope in his resurrection on Easter. Because through our faith, we're provided forgiveness of sin so that no matter what we experience in this world, we know that we can hold on to hope that we have eternal life with him.
Exactly.
And we can hope in all the promises that Jesus teaches us about, and that's just one of them that we share with you today.
Exactly. So this morning, let's light this candle of hope.
Let us pray. O God of hope, Emmanuel, God with us, we pray you to send your light into our hearts at this time. Help us to be ready for the day and the hour of Christ's final appearing. Live in us and help us to live in you. By the power of the Holy Spirit, transform us so that our worship, our celebration, our time of preparation may be pleasing unto you both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Our first reading for this first Sunday of Advent is coming from 1 Samuel, chapter 17, verses 41 through 49. And we're going to hear these words about David. The Philistine came on and drew near to David, with his shields bare in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, his disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the Philistines' army this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword or spear, for the battle of the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." When the Philistine drew nearer to meet David, David ran quickly, drew toward the battle line, and to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell down on the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, striking down the Philistine and killing him. There was no sword in David's hand. Here ends the first reading. The second reading is coming from 2 Samuel, chapter 11, verses 2 through 5. We continue to hear the story of David. David commits adultery with Bathsheba. It happened late one afternoon when David rose from his couch and he was walking about on the roof of the king's house, that he saw from the roof a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. David sent someone to inquire about the woman. It was reported, "This is Bathsheba, daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah, the Hittite." So David sent messengers to get her, and she came to him, and he lay with her. Then she returned to her house. The woman conceived, and she sent and told David, "I am pregnant." This is the end of this reading.
And the whole
Some are waiting for a mighty king, with crimson robes and golden rings, to rule with the strong and powerful hand. But that is not the Father's plan.
Come, Emmanuel.
Come, Emmanuel, the moment is near for all to see and all to hear that faith and hope are born anew, and the whole wide world is waiting.
Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. And the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. As you joined us for worship this morning, you're visually greeted with an Advent wreath, Christmas trees here behind the altar, and the color blue, all inviting us into the season of Advent. But what does Advent even mean, and how does that apply to our lives of faith? Season of Advent consists of looking in two directions and celebrating Jesus, the one who came and the one who will come again. We celebrate what has already come in the past and prepare for what has not happened in the future. Advent, in one way, is an opportunity for us to celebrate what God has already provided each of us as we prepare to celebrate Jesus' birth on Christmas. One activity I invite you to engage in this season that acknowledges God's grace shared with us is by reflecting on the ornaments we or others put up each year on our Christmas trees. It's an opportunity to reflect on how God's grace has accompanied our past. And for example, I have a couple of ornaments to share with all of you as I do this activity myself as by example. So as I hold this ornament up that was recently hanging on our Christmas tree at home, so I have to make sure to return these or I may get in trouble. But this particular ornament, if you can see, is a picture of my children, my oldest, middle, and youngest, two girls and a boy, age 5, 3, and 6 months, because it was taken in 2018 in the month of November while we lived out in Washington State. So as I look towards the past and acknowledge God's grace, I think to myself, not that long ago, I lived out in the state of Washington back in 2018. In between that time, we moved back to Pennsylvania and ended up here in Minnesota. Unfortunately, my children then and now are healthy, doing well in school, have friends, enjoy coming to Trinity as their church, going to Pelican Rapids school districts, and being a part of this community. All of which has part of God's grace. God's grace was shared with my wife and I, Marie, through our children and their experiences in life. And I acknowledge that God's grace is absolutely responsible for all of that happening. And that's something I can celebrate as a part of the past. And another ornament that I can take a look at, acknowledging God's grace in the past of my family, is this ornament. You may or may not be able to tell, is of the picture of a snowman. And it was created in 2021 by my middle daughter. And she did this when we were visiting Alan and Linda Westby's home. During 2021, we got together as families, as friends, as colleagues, and got to eat with one another and do projects connected to Christmas with one another. And it's so wonderful to think that even back in the past, God's grace is good and abounding for us to be connected with a family that is very special and near and dear to our hearts. Both Alan and Linda, and even their children and grandchildren, are a part of that as well. And when we are done reflecting on what God has done for us in the past, we can embrace the reality that God is good all the time. And all the time, you may know the ending to this, God is good. And this includes in the past. We also have the opportunity to think about and prepare for what has not happened yet, or what will take place in the future connected to Jesus' return during the season of Advent. As Jesus said in our gospel reading, they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. Scripture described in the Nicene Creed also states, Jesus will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. But how do we prepare and keep alert for Jesus' return, especially when we don't know when that will be? As readiness is not found in waiting for the exact moment of Christ's return, but by doing our best to live lives of faith in the present. So for a moment, I invite you to let go of the past, not worry about the future, and just focus on the present, the here and now. From the present, we, like our confirmation students this past week, can reflect on the reality of faith and sin in the world connected to our lives now and the life of King David described in our first two scripture readings. We can explore what it means to be ready by being honest with ourselves and each other when we navigate the very real and present temptations of sin and the power of faith in trusting in God's promises. We can learn that sin existed in King David's life as King David broke the sixth commandment by committing adultery or cheating against another person's wife. As this sin is an example of a disruption in our relationship with our neighbors. As breaking commandments 4 through 10 are all examples of relationship disruption with our neighbors. And we had this discussion amongst our confirmation students and the adults taking part about how if we break the fourth commandment by not honoring our father and our mother, that is disrupting our relationship with our neighbors that God calls us to work towards. Whether that's lying to them or not respecting them or not listening to them. Very real when I was a child and very real for many of us out there today. Or the fifth commandment, you shall not murder, which it also includes endangering or harming others. As we can see depicted on the news during Black Friday sales, or whether it's locally on our playgrounds, or even amongst siblings and our families, which I know Alan and I shared was a very real reality for growing up with all boys in our home. Or the sixth commandment, as we mentioned, you shall not commit adultery or cheating. We know that exists back then and now. Seventh commandment, you shall not steal or take advantage of others. It clearly exists. Just look at your phone and how many scam phone calls do you get, or scam emails or texts, or someone trying to take over your Facebook account so that they can reach out to your friends and ask for help. Those commandments are being broken. Sin is real in this world, not only from things we do, but from the actions of others. Or the eighth commandment, you should not bear false witness against your neighbor, tell lies, betray, say bad things about, or gossip. All of those happen. We know they exist even here and now. Or being jealous or coveting your neighbor's house or belongings and trying to claim other belongings as your own. Reality of sin existed during King David's life, and it exists in ours as well. And for us to be ready for Jesus' return, we got to be real in knowing the obstacles that disrupt our relationship with God and disrupt our relationships with our neighbors. And we have things to learn and things to remember. Now, the power of faith and trusting in God's promises was also present in King David's life as well, which is the reason King David beat Goliath, not because of his abilities or his good looks or his skills or luck, but because of his faith and trust in God. That's why he defeated Goliath. For us here and now, we can defeat the consequences of sin through our faith in Jesus, and through our faith also navigate through any challenge this world may bring us, whether we live or die as a result. Through our faith alone, we will be guaranteed victory and join Jesus in a resurrection like his when he returns and have eternal life with Christ. So during this Advent season and beyond, I invite you to be honest with yourselves. Put forth a good faith effort in preparing to celebrate Jesus' birth this Christmas and be ready for his future return by acknowledging what God has done for you in the past. Being real with yourselves and understanding the reality of sin and the power of your faith in the present. And by knowing that God always fulfills God's promises and Jesus will return again. And by doing so, we can celebrate the good news of Jesus during Advent, Christmas, and beyond, and rejoice that God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. Amen. With the whole church, let us confess our faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
With the hope and expectation, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all who await God's day of restoration.
We call your church into holy fellowship as we await the restoration of all things. Re-energize your faithful people to live with hope and compassion, especially those who serve as missionaries near and far. Center us on your promise to come among us and make all things new. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
All creation signals your presence, O God. The vastness of the cosmos, the turn of the seasons, the living things that both rest and flourish, rekindle our commitment to care for the earth. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let the nations tremble at your holy presence, that justice and mercy prevail in all corners of the earth. Restore peace to nations in conflict. Teach righteousness to the corrupt leaders and systems, and bring stability to the areas facing uncertain futures. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Enrich the spirits of all who feel hopeless, fearful, or despairing. Stay close to those who await healing or relief. We remember today Charles Nettested, Megan Harthoon, Ashley Harthoon, Kathleen Runs Doppler, Ardeen Erickson, Carol Zielinski, Don Rongren, Jim Rood, Terry Schustrom, and all others whom we lift before you from our hearts. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Be with those who keep awake at night, the nurses working overnight shifts, the caregivers of newborns and aging adults, those who are anxious and those who are traveling. Reveal to all that the dark can be a place of calm and comfort filled with your presence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. Listen to these and all our prayers, O God of hosts, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us all embrace each other in Christ's reconciling peace.
God's peace, Pastor Eric.
Peace be with you, Alan.
God's peace be with each of you.
At this time, let us give thanks for the offering we receive to proclaim Christ through word and deed here in Pelican Rapids, the state of Minnesota, our country, and beyond. Let us pray. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Well, my friends, as we come to the close of this service, as we go out into the remaining of this day and into the week, go with this blessing. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your backs. May the sun shine warm upon your faces and the snows fall gentle upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Amen.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah.
no more dying there. We are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Well, as we go forth on this day, as we do our best to be ready for the coming of the Son of Man, of the coming of Jesus, as that is connected to the Advent season as well, may we recognize that sin exists in the world, but our way through that obstacle and our way of preparing and being ready for Jesus' return is through having faith, which provides us forgiveness and hope and a direction forward.
So with that being said, let us go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have a blessed Sunday, everyone. See you next week.
God bless.
Soon and very soon.